Hello, and welcome back. In this session, we're going to be talking about ACID transactions. We're going to do a review of what this acronym means, and we're also going to get into why it's important in the context of the modern data lake. Let's dive in. So where does this term ACID come from? Well, it's an acronym, of course, and it's nothing new to the world of data storage systems. It was actually coined by two computer science researchers way back in the 1980s. It's really only been the last few years, though, where we've started to see full ACID support become applicable and available in data lake architectures. This development is largely a result of the recent maturity and popularity of open table formats like Iceberg, Hootie, and Delta Lake. So it's definitely worth diving a bit deeper into this trend. Let's do a quick review of the properties that make up the ACID acronym, and let's start at the top. First, we have atomicity. Atomicity is usually talked about with reference to the concept of transactions. You can think of transactions simply as multiple units of work that are being combined together. The important thing here is that a transaction is atomic, meaning it's all or nothing. Either the entire transaction goes in and it goes in together at a single point in time, or it just doesn't go in at all. Next, we've got consistency. This is often defined as our data always being in a strongly consistent state, even after any particular transaction has been completed. Then we have isolation. Isolation is a guarantee that if we have many concurrent operations going on at the same time, they won't interfere with each other. Another way of stating this is to say that the end results of two concurrent operations will be no different than if those two particular operations were run in sequence. Then finally, we've got durability. Durability just means that any operations we do in our data are safely stored away into some form of persistent and durable storage. In this way, we can confidently retrieve our data later without having to worry about data loss or data integrity problems. Now, let's go a bit deeper on each of these properties. Let's understand how they relate to our modern data lake and what mechanism is enabling them. Okay, so atomicity is going to give us the ability to make sure that multiple units of work can be combined together. This is going to help us avoid situations where we have partial or even incomplete writes, which can easily cause inconsistencies to show up in query results. In our modern data lake environment, we've got a couple of things working in concert that are going to give us atomicity at various levels of abstraction. At the individual table level, we've got the open table format. In our case, that's Iceberg, and that's going to give us atomicity by representing changes as new data and metadata files. We've been referring to these as snapshots. The important thing here is snapshots, new snapshots, never invalidate previous snapshots. At the object level, MinIO is going to give us atomicity through its support for object immutability. Immutability is essentially a guarantee that changes to objects never overwrite the original version of that same object. Finally, we can even do atomic changes in our modern data lake across a set of multiple tables at once. We saw this in our session on Git-like branching, where we used the concept of branches and merging to replay changes from one branch onto another. Consistency is going to give us the ability to enforce schema on write on data inside our tables. This allows us to be confident that our compute engine will refuse to make an update in the event that it might violate some constraints that we previously defined. We get support for strong consistency from MinIO and Iceberg at the object and table level, respectively. At the table level, our compute engine will use our catalog and open table format, Iceberg, to enforce things like schemas, key constraints, and data types. It's going to make sure that these are never violated. At the object level, MinIO is going to give us support for strong consistency through its strict read after write and list after write guarantees on all API calls to retrieve or modify data. Consistency in the data lake environment is a pretty big deal because without it, everything is going to fall back to schema on read. This is going to risk our data lake turning into a data swamp because we won't have proactive ways to govern and control things like schemas, partitioning schemes, and column types. Additionally, consistency is going to allow our compute engine to do various performance optimizations at query time by making use of its knowledge of the format and structure of the underlying data. Isolation is going to make sure that we can safely use our data lake in a multi-tenant environment. We can even do this without introducing concerns about multiple operations getting in each other's way. Isolation in our data lake is going to be achieved by separate mechanisms at write versus read time. At write time, our open table format is typically going to use a strategy referred to as optimistic concurrency. This strategy uses metadata, for instance, version numbers and timestamps, to guarantee that even if two processes are trying to change the same piece of data at precisely the same time, one of them will detect the conflict, abort, and then try again on the recently updated data. At read time, we get isolation through our open table format by simply always doing reads from a single committed snapshot. Isolation is likewise a big deal. Without it, we can't confidently use our data lake for workloads where many order-sensitive changes might be happening at the same time. It's worth also noting that the mechanisms we tend to use for isolation in a modern data lake are a considerable improvement from what was more common in the Hadoop, Hive, and HDFS era. In that era, we generally required the use of table locks, which forced readers and writers to wait in a queue before they could take over the lock and perform the necessary work. Finally, we've got durability. Durability is going to give us the confidence to know that we are protected from data loss. It's also going to help us make sure that the integrity of our data we do choose to store is guaranteed. Object stores, MinIO specifically, provide great guarantees on data durability, and MinIO uses a couple of specific techniques, such as erasure coding and bit rot protection. Erasure coding is going to split our data into what's called data and parity shards, which basically means we can just lose files or even entire drives and still rebuild our data without any downtime. Likewise, bit rot protection is a technique that relies on in-flight hashing of reads and writes to automatically heal any data that might have been corrupted. I'll leave a link in the video description below to a video my colleague did on these topics in case you're interested in going a bit deeper. The key takeaway on data durability is that MinIO object storage is going to give your data lake the best-in-class durability guarantees. All right, so we've got a solid understanding of the properties that make up this ACID acronym. Support for ACID transactions in our data lake really opens up the type of workloads and use cases we can support with this infrastructure. In addition to using our data lake for traditional things like archival storage for logs or maybe exploratory data analysis, we can now use a shared common infrastructure to support hundreds or even thousands of simultaneous users. We can also do this for use cases where we have a need for strong consistency and ordering guarantees. Some examples of these use cases include things like financial reporting systems, real-time booking systems, and even decision support systems that use AI and machine learning. So that's about it for ACID transactions. Thanks for listening, and see you in the next and final session in this series.